it. Yeah. So culture is a big thing, and maybe you should just talk about this more for me today. It's not a whole session, but so that people understand why culture will always eat strategy for breakfast.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you are so right. Culture, it's a difficult thing to to work on because we work with people, and people are coming from different areas and different forms of life.
Senior, you know, grown this up, is how to do it.
Exactly. People have grown up, nature and nurture has taken course over the years, since childhood, you know. And so when they are old and they are working, changing that culture, that mindset, it's not easy. But if you get it right as an institution, as a business, you have arrived.
Would it be right, therefore, to say that for everyone who wants to, let's say, put in place a strategy for anything, now for customer experience, you must first get the culture right?
You have to get the culture right. The truth of the matter is, I would encourage all organizations to drive the customer-centric culture as their strategy, culture strategy. Because that is, if you want to make it, if you want to survive in this industry, the industry we are in, if you want to survive in the business world, you need to drive a customer-centric culture, not any other culture. Because the customer should be at the center of everything that you do as a business. The strategy should be around the customer's expectation and experience. And that's my advice I'll give out there. Customer-centric culture is difficult to attain, but it grows. It grows. I will start by a definition. So we say customer-centric culture is putting the customer focus at the heart of everything you do in order to achieve customer satisfaction and loyalty. So you can buy the systems, you can have the strategies, you can hire the people. If the culture is not right, if it's not customer-centric enough, you will not have that culture, customer satisfaction, and you will not have that customer loyalty. And so you will lose customers, they will churn. And then in the end, you will not get the revenue you need, you will not make the profits you need. You know. So customer-centric culture should be something very critical for every business to look at. Not just any culture. I know we have different types of cultures in organizations, but let's make sure that no matter what culture it is, we add the customer-centric one to it, because that is the reason why we are there.
We should be deliberate and intentional about it.
It should be very
the customer is my lifeblood.
Exactly.
The customer is the reason why I'm here.
Exactly.
If you have to recite it to yourself every morning, you know, somebody said, how do they know unless they hear? And how do they hear unless someone tells them? Exactly. If you say it long enough, you will begin to believe it. It's like all these inspirational things that we read. Somebody said, if you listen to too many inspirational speakers, you go and pick up fights that, you know. But if you wake up in the morning and say, this is my Bible, I am what it says I am. You know, there are things like that we repeat.
Yeah.
I am here to serve the customer. Positive things.
But there's a reason why every company has their vision and mission and their principles all over. Most companies have it scattered all over. The reason is for the staff members to keep seeing it and memorize it.
And all the walls are talking to you, it's all communicating.
There's a reason. You understand? So that is how some organizations drive culture. The sad part is they paste it there and that is it. The last time I went to, I was consulting for a company, and I went there. The reception was there. Behind her was the company principal.
Bold like that.
Boldly. The first question I asked her was, so what is your company's mission?
And she turned.
She didn't even know it was behind her. So, you know, and I have ever been in a company where the MD will let you recite it everywhere he meets you. What are our principles? What are our principles? And in the end, everybody was saying it, wherever you are. And you tend to live by it because you kept breathing it.
If you say it long enough, listening you it, will
exactly,
believe it.
Exactly. Repeating it every single day. You know. So it's very critical. One thing we do know is everyone has a part to play in delivering customer experience or customer-centric culture. The people are actually the culture. So you have to make sure that every single individual in the organization is aware of their role. So what is your role? We write down roles and how do we call them?
Job descriptions
every day. But do the people, are they even aware, your staff? So you have to let them know, what is my role? You are hiring me, what is my role? That's the first question. Who are my customers? Because we have internal customers.
And external customers.
Yeah. And most of the time, staff who are at the back office, have the tendency of thinking they don't deal directly with customers, so it's not their problem.
True.
You understand? But if
they won't pick their phones, they won't respond to emails.
Exactly, because I don't deal with the customer. And when they mess up, they'll come and tell you, you go talk to the customer because you're frontline. So if they know who their customers are and they understand that you are their customer, the frontline staff, you are their customer. And so at the end of the day, you would rate them mm-hmm. on the services they're delivering. That's why we have SLEs. That's why we have all these things. You understand? If they have that appreciation, mm-hmm. then they will know the part they play in the overall experience exactly. to the customer. So you need to let them know who their customers are and then what they are supposed to do for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I am, I'm a back office personnel. Who is my customer? I'm an operations person. Who is my customer? My customer is actually the frontline customer service or the
mm-hmm.
branch.
Mm-hmm.
What do I do for them? I make sure that I work on all the requests they bring at the back within 8 business hours mm-hmm. or whatever, so that they can be happy and in return they can serve the overall.
I'm an IT person. Who are my customers?
Exactly.
Everyone who's using the computing
exactly.
system.
I'm a finance person. Who are my customers? So you need to let every individual in the organization know who they are,
mm-hmm.
who their customers are, and what they are supposed to do for mm. them. It is very critical. I call it employee hero.
Mm.
Because every employee is a hero in their own right. They come every day and they make sure that somebody is happy at the end of the day, whether you are the internal customer or the external customer. So they are heroes. And if you are able to let them know the link, the handshakes between them at the back
mm-hmm.
and the customer who is giving us the money, then they know indeed they are heroes.
Let's spend about just 1 minute on the internal customer conversation, because sometimes in most institutions where the structures are slightly larger, some of the support staff, like you said, the back office staff, do not understand that your interaction may not be direct with the customer, but is indirect.
Yeah.
And therefore, your commission or omission of an error or action directly affects the customer. So let's say that there's supposed to be a transfer. You are the person in the transfer. You're sitting on the Swift transfer. And you're taking your sweet time to do it. There's a cutoff period. The customer wants the transfer to reach a certain place in China so that he will ship his goods 2 days earlier.
Yeah.
You take your sweet time. Friday cutoff is missed. The thing has to get there on a Monday. There are corresponding banks in between.
So
what have you done?
The arrow is
sitting in the branch,
yeah.
tearing his hair because the transfer didn't go through. And the arrow has to go and face the customer. But you have also affected the customer.
Exactly.
You may not be the one facing the customer. You've affected service
to the customer. And the sad part is in this economy we are living in now, the least delay because of the FX volatility, you have to go back to the customer and say, we are sorry, you need to top up before you can pay you can transfer.
I was talking to someone just last week and I was talking about the fact that now people can't even give quotations for prices of fast moving commodities anymore. So while you are on the phone, the price is changing.
You understand? And if we have an appreciation of how our customers feel about this whole thing, we'll do a better job in giving them a good experience by ensuring that even if we are at the back end, we are doing what we need to do and we are being a hero in our own right in delivering that experience to the customer. Because, and I think that is why in most organizations during the customer service week, they'll do the In Your Shoes program and whatnot. Come from the back, sit at the contact center, pick a few calls, and you appreciate, you know, the fact that if you don't do what you have to do, this is how it affects your internal customer.
In some places, what they even do is that, you know how sometimes we think that, and anyway, it depends on perspective.
Yeah.
So sometimes we think that the managers are difficult. They're not approving it. They're not approving that. So sometimes there's a program which is, again, designed by customer experience, which says that, so you spend a day in the front line with the staff. I don't know what you call it. There are different
in
names
your
for
shoes.
It. In your shoes.
So you sit there.
So you come and sit there and hear the customer complain. Next time when we're asking you for approval,
you would yes.
You will be sitting there on your high horse, being difficult about it. You know.
I know their processes. I always say that as managers, we have other things we look at which the other staff would not appreciate. But whatever the case may be, you have to do it right and do it on time, knowing that you have to deliver on a service to a customer. You understand? So, yes, we do appreciate our managers, but, you know, to make sure that they are also employee heroes, you know, they shake their hands along the way.
But it all comes together in one goal and one agenda.
Yeah.
Why are we all here? We're all here to achieve a certain
exactly.
goal.
Exactly.
You know, we may be looking at different things and different processes. I may not be there when the auditor comes to ask questions, but I'm not saying break the rules, but if you're going to do it, do it. If you're not going to do it, say you won't do it. Don't keep me for 4 days waiting, you know. So I suppose the frustrations are all over, but what we are saying here is that we all come together to make the experience memorable for the customer. So don't sit anywhere in the chain of handshakes and say, as for me, I'm looking to process or procedure, therefore the customer can suffer.
Exactly.
You know, it doesn't have to be a yes or no. The experience just has to be memorable. Sometimes some customers actually appreciate you telling them no, it can't be done.
They need is feedback from the organization, you know? The business. And one thing I've realized is the small and medium scale enterprises, the major challenge they have is the third party services. But because guess what? You need to be careful who you use for your third party services. Mm-hmm. For example, now we are I think the e-commerce industry is booming in Ghana. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of online shops. Mm-hmm. And they are heavily dependent on these dispatch riders to deliver items. Mm-hmm. And they forget that the overall experience includes that dispatch who is going to deliver.
Yeah.
I have ever sat in my house when a dispatch rider gives me a call and says, Auntie, please, I need a loan. Just because he's been delivering things to my house. I don't know him. I know him by name. But you see, now it has affected the experience. Like, it's very unprofessional.
Yeah.
You understand? They need to be able to make sure that the people they are dealing with, third party, mm-hmm. are the right people. They believe in their culture. They believe in what they are doing.
And they also benefit from the training, the total training. Exactly.
They invest in them as well. People say, oh, we don't know them. We are just working with a delivery company. And they mess up. They will come late. They will tell you, I'm coming this morning. They will come 9 p.m. at night. You know, and it ends up affecting the overall experience of the customer.
They show up unkempt, frumpy.
Exactly. And most organizations, we also ignore these third-party providers, like the security men, the drivers. We don't train them because they are not directly under us. But we forget that they interact directly with our customers.
Exactly. They're part of the delivery chain.
Exactly. They are part of the delivery chain. And they are part of the perception the customer will have mm-hmm. of the organization. They don't know who they are coming from. Mm. All they know is they are on your premises. Yeah. You understand? So we need to pay attention when it comes to culture. All these people are part of the chain.
Exactly.
And so we need to focus on them. So with that said, we'll focus on 6 ways we can build a customer-centric culture. Mm. The first one is operationalizing customer empathy. What do we mean by that? We want to be able to empathize with our customers. And so we need to train our people, you know, to make sure. So we give them processes that are embedded in empathy. We give them SLAs that are embedded in empathy. So when a customer calls you, 3 rings, pick it up. When you have to deliver on something, you have 8 working hours to do it. You are operationalizing customer empathy. Make sure that it is embedded in all your processes at the back office and the front office. And it's also a part of the training you give your people. The next thing is to hire for customer orientation. Mm-hmm. The truth of the matter is you don't just hire anybody. We have skills and competencies we look at when we are hiring. Mm-hmm. So we have to be very careful. If we know that this is the customer-centric culture we are going with, hire people who are customer-centric. Mm-hmm. You understand? Because something you can train, something you can't train. And I always say me, there are three types of people. That is those who are willing but unable, mm-hmm. and those who are able and unwilling, mm-hmm. and those who are unable and unwilling.
Yeah.
Me, I'll always hire those who are willing but unable, because guess what? You can train them to be able. Mm. So far as they are willing, you can train them to be able. Mm-hmm. So I will hire for competency and train for skill. Mm-hmm. I need you to have the inbuilt attitude, good attitude, for customer-centric attitude. And then we can train you for all the other ones.
I like the third group, unwilling and unable. Maybe you're unable because you're unwilling. I'm just being mysterious.
You know,
they don't want to learn anything.
Exactly.
They can't be bothered.
They can't be bothered. They have become complacent. You understand?
That kind of attitude.
You know, so you need to hire for customer orientation. You need to democratize customer insight. Mm. When you get that insight, don't sit on it. Share it with the business. Let them know what customers are saying about them. Let them know the challenges customers are facing, because you are the holder of all that data. So democratize it. Let it go to ESCO. Let it go to your boss. Let it go to the owner of the company. if it should be so, so that they understand how their customers are feeling. Then they can make good decisions and strategic decisions about the customer. Then you also have to facilitate direct interaction with your customers. Talk to them. So that is surveys, focus group discussions, customer visits here and there. You need to hear from the customers directly.
Feedback
so you
sessions.
Have to, exactly. Then you need to link employee culture to customer outcomes. Let the whole company know that if we have a good customer-centric culture, this is how the customers are going to feel. This is how it's going to go, the ROI we get from it. And then tie the compensation to customer. Most organizations make that mistake. Their bonuses is based on revenue generation. But I know some companies in Ghana whose bonuses are based on customer satisfaction ratings and net promoter scores. Do you know why? Because they have understood that the customer is it. So if our customers don't treat, if our customers don't rate us well, if we are being rated one and twos, why are you in the company? Why are we giving you a bonus? So the bonus is tied to the customer feedback and then the revenue.
Right.
Exactly. So if we are able to do something like that, then everybody will set up because they know the customer is the one paying them. It is the customer's sentiment that is going to give you your annual bonus. You work towards that good sentiment for the customer.
Where your treasure is.
That is where your heart is. And you work hard at it. So, you know, those are the six ways we can build customer-centric culture. You know.
Very impressive indeed. Let's just chip in one more fact and then we'll get interactive. So those were the six, well, I think six or seven. I will probably go over them again before we... There are six of them.
Yeah.
But then again, we also want to look at organizational accountability, isn't
it? Yes.
Right, so let's talk about that quickly before we get interactive.
So what is organizational accountability? It is about holding employees and executives responsible and accountable for accomplishing customer-centric cultures and making decisions that deliver on these customer-centric expectations. So you see, it's both... employees and executives. I always say, and in customer experience, we say the overall accountable for customer centricity culture is the CEO. That is where the buck stops. He is the champion of a customer centric culture and customer experience. That is where the buck stops. So he is overall accountable. But we have to hold executives responsible, which most institutions currently do not do. It's critical to hold them responsible. How do you do that? First and foremost, put together a customer experience governance. Like we have governance for everything. We do have governance for customer experience. So you need to put that there. We have the core team. We have an executive sponsor. It can be the MD. We have a steering committee that meets on a monthly basis or quarterly basis. We have a working group. We have ambassadors or business partners in every department. Put together a governance. How many times you are going to meet? You know, have a policy. Everything that you do under governance, have same for customer experience.
For customer experience, yeah.
That is how you drive organizational adoption. Then that's the first one, governance. The second one is align customer experience to other organizational areas. Break down the silos. We like working in silos. I'm finance, there's nothing customer experience about me. I'm IT, there's nothing customer. Break down that silos. Let them know that the customer is the focus. And after that, they map out the journey of the customer. Once you know the journey of the customer, you can build the processes on the journey. And then you go for the technology that will bring the processes to life. So you have that three layers. And if you're able to get that three layers and get the responsible for each layer of that three layers, you know that you've broken down that silo.
It's interesting you talk about silos. I'd like to ask a question on the back of that. But before we do that, we'll take a quick message from our sponsors. We'll be right back.
Equia has sickle cell disease. Kweku is battling with prostate. Auntie Mary has a family history of cancer. All these people have either inherited a genetic disorder from parents and present in the child at birth or even due to some environmental factors. Remember that genetic conditions affect all ages, economic, social, and religious groups. Don't discriminate if they look different. Early detection may help early intervention and treatment. As we start the GA Genome Project, we invite you to join and follow our public lecture series and get free genetic testing and screening. For more updates and information on how to get the free genetic testing and screening, call 0302-959-246 or visit www.gagenome.org.
Your favorite on-air business development program, Joy Business Masterclass, is in session. And you can interact with us on Facebook via the Joy 99.7 FM or Joy Business pages. If you tweet, the handle is at Joy997FM or at JoyBusinessGH. Don't forget to hashtag JB Masterclass. You can also call us on 0302-216541 or send your questions and contributions through to the WhatsApp number 0551-111997 and our facilitators will address your concerns. Attention everyone, class is in progress.
Welcome back. If you've just tuned in, this is Masterclass here on your Superstation Joy 99.7. We're interactive right now. Numbers to call 0302-216-541. That's 0302-216-541. You can also send us your comments on 0551111997. We're talking about customer experience here. What's the one customer experience that you had this week? I'd like to hear it. And we're talking about organizational adoption and customer experience. Being customer-centric, that's what we're talking about. Pick up that phone, give us a call, 0302-216-541 or 0551111997. Do you have any motor vehicle of any kind? Because if you do, Goyle has some great news for us. Goyle, your oil marketing company of choice, keeps making life ever so convenient. Goyle now accepts Momo for all fuel purchases at key selected stations. Just remember to Momo it at Goyle. And that is not all. You can also use your bank card to buy fuel at Goyle, and this is made possible by Absa. Drive to any of our Goyle filling stations now and buy your fuel. Pay by Momo or a bank card, and you're good to go. Goyle, good energy. Goyle, Yenara, Yedia. GH Genome. Did you know that disorders like sickle cell disease, breast and prostate cancers have a genetic component? Genetic conditions affect all age, economic, social, and religious groups. The GH Genome Project includes public lectures on the Ghanaian genome and free genetic health screening of sickle cell diseases, breast and prostate cancers. We invite you to join the GH Genome Project. Follow us and get screened. Early detection may help early intervention and treatment. For more updates, call us on 0302-959-246 or visit us at www.ghgenome.org. GH Genome, our duty to decode. Phone lines are now open. Numbers to call 0302-216-541. You can also send us your comments on 0551111997. Customer experience. What is the one customer experience that you had this week? We want to hear about it. Was it good? Was it bad? If you're an owner of a company, what is the customer strategy? What is the customer philosophy that you are running in your company? And what are the experiences that your customers have when they come and they deal with you? Do they want to come back? Let's share some thoughts. Life is too short to make all the mistakes yourself. So let's learn from other people's mistakes that we can all be better. Pick up that phone. Give us a call. 0302-216-541. While we're waiting for the phone line to ring, you're talking about working in silos.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, one of the challenges we have as organizations, especially the bigger ones, is working in silos. And I always ask, when I'm consulting for people, I ask them, as the people's executives sitting at the top, do you talk to each other? They say yes. And I say, so if you talk to each other, do you communicate it to your subordinates along the way? That is where the issue is. So they'll make all these nice decisions at the top. For example, marketing is bringing out a new campaign. For example, IT is going to undertake a new system upgrade or whatever. Operations is working on a new payments portal or whatever it is. The front line will always be the last people to know. Changes are coming in HR. Other departments will be the last people to know. But the executives are very well aware.
They signed it off.
Exactly, they signed it off.
Yeah.
But then after that, what next? That is where the silos come in. Because then only their teams are aware of what is happening. The rest of the businesses are not aware. And if that is how things are working, how do you deliver the overall experience? You, at times, you'll be in the front line and systems are down. And it is customers that will call the contact center to let you know
and
that your payment system is down.
Who's watching it? Who's monitoring it?
Exactly.
Why are they not communicating?
You are going to do a new campaign. Why are they not communicating to the front line? You'll be there and calls will start coming into the call center. Then you call it. What is happening? Oh, we have a new campaign going on. That's why people are calling. You understand? So
Not.
So we need to break down those silos if we want a customer-centric organization.
I got my first caller on the line. Good afternoon. You're welcome to Masterclass. Your name and
good afternoon, boys. I hope you're doing well.
Hello, good afternoon.
Afternoon, boys. Price, you're doing well.
Thank you.
This is Ajuan Joseph from
Kenya. Oh, my brother, how are you?
I'm very strong.
Good. Talk to me.
I think the issue of customer culture should be enlightened some time to come. Sometimes when you go to a certain community, then the business owners will say that, oh, ask for this place. This is what they like. Oh, if you buy this, they won't buy. They always come and ask for this. So when they are filling in their stores, they have to make sure a particular product should be more in their shop. So the culture of buying should be discussed, I mean, later. Okay, before I come out to my customer experience, I have a brief question. If I'm buying online and let's say I choose an item thinking that the amount is supposed to be a certain amount of money, but when it came to me, not only what I saw on the internet, is different from what the rider is telling me I should pay. If I end up not buying, how do I go about it in terms of paying the rider, the search rider? I mean, does the owner of the item have to go along with me so that we share the cost of the ride? That is my question. My customer experience just yesterday, I was going to buy a bottle of water and I was pointing a particular water I've been buying, and I think it's very good for me. There was a certain water I haven't tasted before. I don't even know of it. I just saw it just yesterday. But the owner was putting pressure. Buy it. It's nice. It's good. I know why I'm putting it on you. Buy. Ah, madam. So in the end, she ended up reducing it for me. And I said, okay, let me buy it and taste it. After buying it, I could see that it is very good, as she was recommending.
Mm-hmm.
So it's rather unfortunate that I normally don't go there. So now, whenever I get that water, I have to buy that water. So I think my customer experience yesterday was very, very good.
Brilliant.
Thank you very much for this program.
Thank you so much, Ajima Joseph. And his customer experience, I mean, if it's been memorable and it makes him want to go back,
that's good. That's what's important.
Then it's good.
That's how he perceives the whole situation.
So. And he's talking about a bad sale. And how to handle the payment of it, either the dispatch or the product itself.
Well, so this is where I talk about the third-party services.
Mm.
You need to have processes in place. Most of the time, if you are an e-commerce person or you are an online business, you have to clearly state the terms and conditions to the customer.
Yeah.
Let them know that they are the ones who are going to foot the bill for the delivery, or you are the one that's going to foot the bill.
The product is X amount. Delivery
is this amount. Or you can say you can pay directly to the delivery guy, or you can send it to me via mobile money. Whichever it is, you have to be very clear about it to the customer at the point of purchase.
Mm.
So they know what the decision is and they act on it. So he has every right to get back to the company and tell them that I'm not happy with this service or whatever it is. Yeah.
I've got a comment on social media. You didn't add your name for me. It says, hello, please, may I know if ECG is part of this customer service thing. I live in Osu and I've been given a new meter, which I cannot purchase credit in my area unless I go to Accra. Okay, you didn't add your name. But this is a question from, is it Nancy? Nancy Apafo.
Interesting. So, Customer Experience Professional Ghana is an association.
Mm-hmm.
And so we invite everyone in the all organizations and customer experience professionals and practitioners to join us. I'll have to confirm if we have any ECG as staff as our member.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think that if you have any challenges, you can always call their call center.
Mm.
I've been informed they are very pretty good. So you can complain to them and they can pick it up and then work on it for you. I expect that should be done for you.
Mm. Okay, so there you go, Nancy. I've got a caller on the line. Good afternoon. You're welcome to Masterclass. Your name and where you're calling from.
Nanama, I'm calling from Butche.
Good afternoon. Sorry, Nanama, how is Butche this afternoon?
Oh, everything is fine. Hello?
Yes, talk to me, Nanama. You're alive.
Okay, please, I want to ask extra questions. Hello?
Go ahead, Nanama, go ahead. We're listening to you.
Okay. The last, I wanted to ask that if you are an employer and someone employ you to come and work for her at a salon, so maybe the time that the person was, oh, come and work is 7:30, but due to our traffic and stuff, so maybe you get to work around 8 o'clock. But the moment you get there, the owner will be insulting you, using some bad words on you. So this case, you know, how will you, the work, how will you go about it? Because you are not learning it. You are doing work and pay. But she's paying you. Hello?
Nanama, it's a brilliant question. Please keep listening. We will answer the question shortly.
I have another question?
Okay, go ahead, Nanama.
Okay, my second question is, like, you order something online. You pay the money already. But when the delivery guy deliver it, the thing looks different. Maybe for example, you are buying rich and you order, you pay. And they give you the delivery guy to deliver it for you. But when the rig came, the amount that you pay, no, it's not like the rig. Maybe the rig is fake. But you have paid the money already. So in this case, so how will you go about it? Do you have to go straight to the shop? I don't know. So I want to...
Thank you so much, Nanama.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Please keep listening. She's got two questions. If you can just react very quickly.
So the first one, I always say that, I always tell my team, because I also work with people, when you know you are going to be late, the best thing you can do is alert me of the delay. We are human. We know the situation, the traffic and all that. So just let us know. Because maybe somebody is dependent on you. You are supposed to open the shop, or you are supposed to come before somebody else leaves. So please, Ananama, there are lots of things that we do that naturally we feel like our bosses should understand. But we are human. So if you take the initiative, some of these things, to prompt early on, I'm sure that she would not be that upset. I am not holding brief for the boss. However, I also think from that side of that point of view, that as a boss, you should let the staff members or the people you work with be very clear on your rules and regulations, be very clear on their processes and all of that, so that if they are going astray from the process, you have every right to work on them. If you have to groom them, if you have to discipline them or whatever it is, you do it knowing that they are fully aware of how it's supposed to be. I do not condone, and this is my personal feeling about this. Yeah. I do not condone employers mistreating, manhandling, or verbally abusing employees. Under no circumstances should that be done.
So discipline, but don't abuse.
Exactly.
Okay, let's go to the next question very quickly if we can.
Good. The next one, yes. So, Nanama, you have every right to go back and complain to the company or to the shop you bought the wig from. You have every right to go back and complain. It's your right as a customer. You chose one item. What came is not what it is. It happens to all of us. You can always go back and demand for your money.
Right. I've got a final comment on social media. This one is from Edem from Tema. I said, thank you for the refresher course on customer experience. How can an old state organization with structures already firmly in place adopt and implement customer service? Lastly, the policy content is informative. I congratulate our resource expert for his smooth and clear delivery. How can an old state institution with existing structures deliver? And while you answer that, round up for me today and give us our takeout points for today.
So old institutions always have legacy issues. We know legacy systems, legacy people, legacy policies.
Legacy and problems.
And they are always big ones. But there's what we call customer experience transformation. Mm. It is a type of business transformation. And so we have, and that is why we as Customer Experience Professionals Ghana are here. We are supposed to assist organizations, you know, drive experience transformations. So if you are listening to me, no matter how old the institution is, you can always undergo a customer experience transformation. Oh. Put in the proper processes, revise and review all your policies to make it more customer-centric, drive organizational adoption, put in place proper customer experience strategies, mm-hmm. and ensure that you are aligning your overall business, no matter how old it is or how matured it is, to the new way of doing things. Because the world is going customer-centric. And the earlier that all these old institutions told the way of customer-centricity, the faster they would survive, or the quicker they will survive in this digital world.
Where there's a will, there is a way. What are we doing next week? What should we look forward to?
We are looking at voice of customer and how to measure them. So that is what we are looking at for next week.
Thank you so much. We've run out of that's all time will allow us. This has been Masterclass here on your Superstation Joy 99.7. God willing, next week we come your way again with another exciting edition of Masterclass. Thank you for staying with us. See you next week.
Double double. Yes, so HD Plus has brought the recorded double double promo this World Cup season. Watch the World Cup feely on your HD Plus decoder and get the chance to visit Dubai feely with your partner this December. So you see, you win double double. If you have an HD Plus decoder, subscribe 3 months and above and dial *844*8# to enter the draw. If you don't have a decoder, rush and buy one at an authorized dealer or any Electroland outlet to enter the draw. Additionally, there are over thousands of prizes such as TV sets, microwaves, and many electronic appliances to be won. Dial *844*#, and win big in the recorded promo from now till 5th December 2022.
Next promo is in partnership with the NLA on the Caritas Lottery platform.
What do the following have in common? Kofi Bedu, Elizabeth Ohine, PAV Ansah, Kweku Sechi Ado, Professor Kwame Kakari, Gifty Afenyi Dadze, Cabral Blay Amihir, Kwesi Pratt Jr., Kweku Bako, Godwin Abenyogbo. They are the bold and beautiful of Ghanaian journalism. The legends whose pens and microphones proved mightier than the sword of dictators. Sir Sam Jonah, Lawyer Akoto Ampal, Honorable KG Oseibonsu. Three non-newsroom actors who, with independent-mindedness, fought for the removal of impediments to media freedom. Awards dinner, Wednesday, the 21st of September, 2022. Venue, Cleaver House, Accra. Gracing the occasion will be His Excellency John Ajikum Kufuor, special guest of honor, Mr. Kwame Pienim, chairing His Majesty Nana Kobina Nketiah V.
MC, Chairman General, Kwame Sefakai.
This advertisement is by the proud sponsorship of Joy FM, Joy News, Joy Prime, and Adom TV.
You have built nations of men. You will make great men of them.
You will guide us all and lead us to land that we may see. So to stand to meet us all shall be their own.
Rallies to the valley, students of Christendom.
Coming soon on Hits FM.
Are you that football brain with all the facts of the FIFA World Cup at your fingertips? Have you followed the world's biggest sporting event religiously over the years? Have you retained the big moments and the not-so-big ones, as well as those that others will ordinarily overlook? Then get ready for the Qatari Quest Quiz right here on Joy 99.7 FM, Fridays from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. Care to know what the itinerary is? Well, this is it. The qualifiers will be from September 9 to 30. The quarterfinals will be staged between October 7 and October 21. The semifinals between October 28 and November 4. And of course, we get to crown the big winner in the grand final on November 11, 2022. For registration, follow all Joy Sports social media handles. The Qatari Quest Quiz is right here on your superstation Joy 99.7 FM. The Qatari Quest Quiz is produced by Joy Sports.